or not even August anymore, September 1st. Looky there, I got the right month. And I'm your host, Captain Chris, and today we have a great show for you. We are talking a lot of controversies as well as a little bit about what it takes and means to buy a game under as a gamer and now today, as well as lots of other topics, including Guild Wars 2 going free to play. So, we have to my right, Anna of Hickville Productions. She does art and lots of other things, as well as some awesome Let's Plays and lots of other things. Down below me, we have Evan the Pixel Pusher, who does Let's Plays, YouTube, and lots of other things as well, mostly chopping meat. And then
I have been this weekend.
And then we have Alice Andura, who does a lot of stuff on YouTube, has a blog for beauty and gaming. So if you are interested in either of those topics, go and check out her stuff. So, and I'm Captain Chris, and I do live streams and all sorts of stuff, as you probably know, since this is my channel. And you're here now. So let's go ahead and chat a little bit about our first topic, which is the hidden under the box in the room. And sorry, that's a very corny transition into this topic, but Metal Gear Solid 5 came out, well, today. So, as far as I know. And the reviews are in. All 10 out of 10s, pretty much from everyone, which is makes this a must-own game for every gamer. But I will be picking it up. And I kind of wanted to discuss the reasons why.
I didn't mean that. I'm sorry. I didn't mean that.
You can hear the instant regret in Evan's voice.
I know, right?
It I'm could sorry. Be fake
that
regret.
That was wrong. I shouldn't have said that.
Evan's never wrong, right? So
but, you said it, not me.
Oh, well. Sometimes you are, sometimes you're not. So... now, what I really want to get into is why I want to put legs to my conviction, which is the popular idea of from Konami or Jim Sterling, which I cannot speak of because it's a family-friendly podcast, but that hashtag describes my feelings for Konami in general.
And Konami!
When I hear about the working conditions where people are basically, in my eyes, put into slave labor with the cameras always watching them and literally being publicly humiliated if you do anything wrong or if you offend the boss in any way or disagree with them, pretty much. You get forced into menial tasks until you quit or go insane, or it's being asked to do tasks that you're not equipped to do in the first place, like send out official company emails using Hotmail accounts because they cannot equip their employees with proper domains in proper times. Yes, official Konami employees sometimes are forced to use Hotmail accounts to reach out to other publications. Why? Because, well, Konami wants to monopolize pretty much the market. They want to force their employees into this idea of subservient business, and to me, that's akin to slave labor. So I do not support their business practices, so I do not support their game or anything produced using that type of labor, which is why I won't be picking up Metal Gear Solid 5. Now, what I wanted to bring to the topic of the podcast, though, is not whether, not that, but is it right to buy a game that you disagree with how it's made?
It doesn't really. I think in most cases, I don't much mind how my game is made. I mean, I worked in the very, very corporate America. I worked in the finance industry for 5 years, and I worked a very demeaning job before that that Evan has also experienced from the male side of things.
Yes.
So, I mean, I've been put through horrible things at my job, so I don't really look at things like what Konami does and go, oh no, I work with companies all the time from China, Korea, areas like that, where they do use a lot of like Gmail accounts and stuff like that for their communications. So those things don't really affect me. The only time that I do tend to boycott games because of how they were made is issues like what happened with Candy Crush, where it was like a direct ripoff of an indie game. Like the fonts, the game, the upgrades, everything was a direct rip. I did boycott that game for that reason only.
Okay, so that's an interesting thing. So an asset flip or taking someone else's work and then completely ripping it off is a valid reason to actually not engage in that game. There's another one from what I remember, like Total Biscuit talking about. It's like 2048 or something like that. It's one of those match numbers that
match three games.
That did the same thing, and he gets on that topic a lot. But yeah, I think that's a good reason to boycott again. So anyone else want to chime in or?
Pretty much with A-List. I don't know, like, I'm not going to buy the game anyway because I haven't played most of the Metal Gears. The only one I played was like the first one.
Yep.
Second of all, I don't normally buy games that are $60 just because I don't think a video game is worth $60 for me at the moment.
Yeah.
I don't agree with how they treat their employees, but I mean, I work in a secure hallway at my job. It's why I don't talk about what my job is, because it's kind of like, but you know, I can understand why it's crazy. Because I mean, for movies, for instance, they will transport the screenplay in a armored truck with a bunch of other armored trucks just to keep everything hush hush so no one else can steal their stuff. So I can get why they're under surveillance and things like that. Does it suck? Yeah. Now, like the public shaming and stuff that you mentioned earlier when you and I were talking before we started streaming, that, no, I think that's crossing the line, but, you know, I'm not going to be buying the game anyway, so.
Yeah, well.
It would make me think twice, though, before purchasing a game from them in general.
Yeah.
I'm in sort of the same boat. When it comes to, like, yeah, you hate the public shaming. And honestly, I've sort of seen myself a lot of that here in America, too. So it's not like it's just over in Japan. They do a lot of that kind of stuff. They'll move you to a different department and give you a really crud job because apparently it's really, unless you are seriously screwing up at your job, it is very hard to sort of get fired in a lot of places.
Yeah.
Nowadays, they can't specifically fire you for one specific thing. They have to make you quit. And if you fire, and if you get fired, it has to be for a super serial offense. You know.
Yeah.
When it comes to the stuff like what Konami's doing, I think I get what Anna is saying about, like, you know, when it comes to secrecy, you know, I kind of understand the monitoring. It's a bit much, but you have to understand that the industry they're in, you try to keep all of that hush-hush. I mean, it is sort of a, I guess you could call it a human rights issue. But, But when it comes to actually buying the game, I'm with Anna. I don't play the game. I might at one point. But I actually downloaded it was like Metal Gear Solid Ground Zeroes on, like, I have it on both my PC and on Xbox One because they were giving it away for free. I've yet to even play it.
Yeah.
Like, I like the stealth action games, but I just haven't gotten around to play it. It's one of those games. I never had like a PlayStation or anything to play it on when I was younger. So I just never got to play it. I've never gotten into it. So I mean, maybe at one point I will play it since apparently it's getting really good reviews. But I don't think I'm going to be like, oh my gosh, after the podcast, I'm going to go buy it, you know, day one and start streaming it tonight. It's not really a game that I feel like I need to play right away.
Well, from what I know and what I see, this game is going to be as big as probably Grand Theft Auto 5. And I'm not joking. I'm not just saying that. Like, this is going to be ubiquitous in the gaming world. And I think it's going to be the next big stream game. Again, like, if you want to get popular, this is probably the way to do it. This game, if you start playing it right now, you will build your channel on Twitch. There is no doubt about it in my mind.
And be buried under all the other more popular people.
I don't think so. This is one of the games where I think that just like Metal Gear Solid, or just like Grand Theft Auto, you will literally can play this game infinitely with how it is and do derpy things and do a lot of cool things all the time and still make it, even if you, like Minecraft, you start a channel on YouTube right now, base it around Minecraft, you can hit 2,000 subs before I hit, you know, 100 easily. You know, I just hit 100 this last week. But, you know, like, you still can make it on games like that. And I believe, from what I'm reading in the winds, that this is one of those games. I just have this feel in my bones that this is the game of this year. So, that's just how I see it.
Yeah, well, as I'm looking at it right now, there's already 88,592 viewers on Metal Gear Solid 5 streaming right now. Let's look at those numbers, shall we? The first maybe 10 people have over 1,000 streamers. It goes down in the hundreds as you keep going down and down and down and down. There are pages of people streaming this game. Pages, pages, oh, yeah. Pages. Now, again, it all comes down to if you're streaming it at midnight, maybe you'll get it. Or doing a 24-hour, you might get it. But I feel like once you have the people at the top, that there is literally a guy at the top of this at this page. I got to scroll all the way back up now. That has 43,000 Lyric. Lyric's playing it now. Lyric's taking all the viewers.
Well, Lyric will go back. Lyric 43,000
viewers.
Once this is over. What I'm saying is once the major streamers get out of the story mode, and this goes back to community, then you have a real shot at actually getting noticed. So, and again, it's like GTA, okay? Granted, you're not going to get a bajillion views, but let's face it, if I make a GTA 5 video and make it funny, it'll get my right now, today, it will still get more attention than 9/10 of my videos, okay? Or any of our videos, tell you the truth. So that's what I'm trying to say is, yes, right now, live streaming at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, there's 80,000 people watching it. Okay? Put that in perspective. If we can get one person to watch and build our audience from there and gain one fan to try and show that we're a variety, then of course we're going to get bigger. Okay? And I really think that this is the game to do it on. If there is any game that's coming out this holiday, that or Fallout. Okay, so
Fallout definitely.
Metal Gear Solid 5 is probably going to win Game of the Year over Fallout 4. I'm not, and I hate to say that. I'm a Fallout fanboy. Okay, but what I'm seeing from Metal Gear Solid 5, the recipes in that game, what I've seen from the gameplay elements, it plays and looks like a perfect game. You can spend 300 hours in it, not even scratch the surface of the content.
Which is exactly why I'm not playing it.
Because
it takes way too much time to play that game. I don't have that kind of time.
Well, that's
It's sort of the same reason why I don't play a lot of giant RPGs anymore. Like, Tales of Zestiria? That's probably going to be the first major RPG I've played in a long time.
Yeah.
Because I haven't played a Tales game in forever, since Tales of Vesperia a couple of years ago. And I can actually play it. It's going to be on PC. Hopefully it will be a decent port, and I'll be able to play it. But that's a game that you could play in small portions because of like the combat system and the way that sort of works.
Yeah.
I don't know if that makes any sense. But like I work 40-hour-plus-a-week job.
Yeah.
Heck, I even had to work today, what was supposed to be on my day off. I don't have time to play a 300-hour game anymore. By the time I get the fourth of the way through that game, I'm not interested anymore.
Yeah.
I just don't care.
From what I can see, you can beat the game in 30 hours. Okay. That's what I've heard. And that's not like speed running. That's just taking your average time. What I'm saying is the open world elements, and this is seen in just Ground Zeroes, which is like one map. It literally will. You can play the same base and go for complete stealth takedowns, and like no gun runs and things like that that will keep the game interesting. Like no horse use or, you know, like that type of thing. Which the horse kind of looks jank from what I've seen in the gameplay, from what I see. Because you can literally go by outpost by getting on the side of the horse and like shimmying down the side of the horse. It'll work just like the boxes back in the old Metal Gears.
I've seen that.
The guards will literally not notice you if you're on the side of the horse. So
give me another Splinter Cell game.
Well, that's what I mean. Is this a Splinter Cell open world? That's what I mean is they successfully pulled off a open world stealth action game, which has never been done before, and they did it well. If that makes sense. So
a Hideo Kojima game.
Yes. Well, without
what Konami is doing with Metal Gear. No, what Hideo Kojima is doing with Metal Gear.
Yeah, well,
we have to constantly remind people of that.
That's true. And that's the thing, is I kind of want to play it, given the fact that I really think that this is going to be one of the biggest games of this year, if not the biggest, okay? From what I've seen, I mean, GameSpot and IGN, both perfect 10 out of 10s. No, like, I've not seen that since Ocarina of Time. Okay, and I'll just be straight up honest. And, I mean, I love Fallout, but it's going to be Fallout. Okay, and I love Fallout. This is something new. Okay, well, it's not like new, but it's something different than what came before. So, that's what I think is going to be good, if that makes sense.
I'm still holding out. It's a dream. It's a very far-fetched dream. But I'm still holding out the fact that maybe, possibly, Kingdom Hearts 3 could come out in December. It's a dream. Look, they've had a lot of time to work on this game. And they've already said that since they switched to the new engine, it has really streamlined their development process.
Yeah.
So it's not out of the realm of possibility that in November they'd be like, yeah, we're really proud to announce that it's coming out in December and you don't have to wait till next year. But it's not going to happen. But if it did, you heard it here first.
Yeah.
Just saying.
Furball brings up a topic. Actually, I want to kind of transition into this. Well, I want to transition to something else. But while we're on Metal Gear Solid 5, let's go ahead and talk about the review process, because Devious Furball mentioned in chat that IGN reviews mean nothing because they can be bought, and all these reviews mean nothing to me because of how the reviews were done. They did what's called a review event, where reviewers have flown in, and literally you play the game under monitor. With a PR person over your shoulder, you can't do anything. You can't get up to use the bathroom, blah, blah, blah. You have to play the game during a set amount of time, during set conditions, and you only get a certain amount of time with the game, and then bam, you can't really do anything. So I do not like that reviews, or any reviews under these circumstances, so I will disregard this. But what I am seeing from gameplay and from reviews and critical acclaim is that this is gosh darn near a perfect game, okay, for pretty much most audiences, okay? And that is what kind of worries me, is I don't want to support this game, but as a gamer, like, I...
You'll buy it.
This game has the stuff. Like, I know it.
Yeah.
You'll buy it eventually.
Well, I don't want to, though. That's
the
thing.
But you will. You will. That's what they're counting on, Chris.
Yeah, I know,
you'll
right?
You'll buy it no matter what anybody says.
Well, and this is the big thing. Yeah, corporate commander. Screw. I can't wait for Angry Joe's episode on this, actually. So,
you know you're going to buy it, Chris. You may hold out for a week or two, but you'll see those ratings, and then they'll be like, I can't take it anymore.
It's not that. It just looks like
and
so much
just throw
fun
money
to me.
At Konami again.
Konami! Why do you gotta make one good game? Why can't you just hit the freaking lever and put out crap? Oh, just go into a hole and just not make anything ever again.
Well, hitting the lever on our fan base because they're just throwing money at us.
Oh, jeez. So, I got to put them in. But yeah, that's Metal Gear Solid 5 in a nutshell. And I wanted to transition into Squeenix because Square did something stupid over the past day. So let's talk about some pre-order policies for the Deus Ex game coming out February 23rd, which is announced this week. So Deus Ex got a release date this week at PAX. Well, it had like no news in it whatsoever. But
disappointing.
Yeah, well, actually, I liked a lot of PAX, but let's stay on topic. Square Enix made this stupid announcement of the pre-order bonuses, where if you pre-order Deus Ex Mankind, you can lock into specific pre-order bonuses. So, say you want to be combat or whatever, you get pistol rounds, exclusive skins for the pistol, blah blah blah. But what gets me is some of the pre-order bonuses. They are literally missions in the story that if you pre-order, you unlock if the pre-orders get to that point. So that's cutting content from the game in order to lock it behind a pre-order wall. And on top of it, if you pre-order, this is astounding to me. The game will come out 4 days earlier for you if the pre-order list was, or if they get a certain amount of pre-orders. That is stupid to me. Why don't you just release 4 days earlier anyways?
This is commonplace, though. That's happened for the last decade. I used to hand out pre-order codes to people at my store for a week early access to a bunch of games, and the paywall thing, we just saw that with Arkham Knight, where you could only be Harley Quinn if you had pre-ordered, which to people like me who are absolute Harley fanatics, it was kind of BS, because you're losing out on that character if you choose not to pre-order and just grab it on Steam like everybody else.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's and then the fact of the matter is, like, 5 months later, or whenever they want money, they're going to be like, yeah, sup, you can buy Harley Quinn's level for $7 and or whatever it is on Steam. I haven't played that. But they will release that DLC, like, yeah, it's exclusive, except when we want to make more money. So
Just wait for the Game of Year edition. That's what I do. Just, like, unless it's content that is, like, super detrimental to the game, like for COD, for instance, like, I mean, buy a season pass for COD because people play COD for the multiplayer, and you don't want to get left behind when it comes to all the maps and all the new things when it comes to zombies and things like that. But if it's extra missions that doesn't have too much to do with the story, it's just extra content, so, like in Batman, wait for the Game of the Year edition, then you can play all of it at one time, and you don't have to worry about it.
Yeah, like Destiny. So, where we
like Destiny.
Yeah.
Stupid so, Destiny.
So
I
where
hate so much.
Where okay. we're like, yeah, let's spend all this, and this is my big thing, is my friends are all like, yeah, we are done with Destiny, but Taken King's coming out. Hey Chris, you gonna buy it? You gonna buy it? I'm like, no, I'm done with that game. Stop it. I got all the exotics. I'm done. So,
I can't believe you got that, dude. I couldn't even play. Dude, I got one exotic. I said, this takes way too much work.
I got three icebreakers, man.
Anymore.
Three. I loved. That's the only exotic I really used was Icebreaker and Gjallarhorn, which I gotta tell you, one of the basic, one of the basic things we used to do on Raid was every time you shot Gjallarhorn, you'd go like, Gjallarhorn! And every time you shot that, and no one, that's what made that weapon so great, is just like eight people shouting Gjallarhorn when ATN was in the burn phase. So, yep.
I got a Devious Furball pointed out the whole you're basically choosing which content you get with the pre-order. I'm going to show my age here and say, back in the day for EverQuest expansions, oh my god. when they started offering digital downloads, when we got to that point they started offering the expansions in a digital form, you actually did get different things in the game and out of the game, whether you pre-ordered it for a digital download or you pre-ordered a standard edition. So the standard edition would get a certain set of armor in the game along with a coin, a map, and a little statuette. Like one of them was a little cat that was the mount in the game.
Yep.
And the digital download got their whole set of separate stuff. So it literally was a decision between what you wanted inside the game.
Yep, and that is the worst practice ever. Because like me, I'm like, I have to have all the cosmetics. I don't know why like that's built into me, because I will only use like one costume ever. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
but
right.
Costumes aren't a big thing for me. I'll find, like, I'll work up to the one that I want, and once I have it, I just stay there. You know,
that's pretty much what I do.
Unless there's something very, very, like, unless that you can mix and match costumes to make a certain look or something like that, I may switch it around. But, like in COD Advanced Warfare, they had, you know, different, like, exo suits and things like that. I found one combination I thought really made me look cool, and I just kept it there. I don't care about the rest of that stuff. So costume packs, unless it's really friggin' awesome, I don't care.
Well, no. I'm talking, like, exclusive beta things. So back in the day, back for Halo 3, when...
It's not that long ago.
It's, like, 7 years now, 8 years. So, mm-hmm. I think... So,
came out the year my kid was born.
So,
I love how that's how you associate things. It's like, yeah, that game came out.
Well, that's how I do it. Like, that's actually how I do it. I'm like, yeah, that was before Abigail's birth or after Abigail's birth.
Exactly.
And that's, I mean, kids change you, so they do things. And Ayla's is like roll of the eyes, whatever.
Wait till you have your second one, sweetheart.
Yeah, well, that's not happening. Sorry, not gonna happen. But
not for a while, anyway.
No. But but the flaming skull thing, right? The flaming helmet. Does anyone remember that?
Ayla's got locked out of chat. I'm sorry.
Oh, Moobot.
You got me with the Moobot.
Dude, bullfighting justice.
I tried to give it to you, but Chris's Moobot decided that I'm not allowed. So go send me a message on Twitter. It's at Ayla's Andura, and I will give you my Steam.
You're OP'd, so you should be. I need to unblock you, though.
That strikes again.
That was my helmet. I don't know what that was.
Try typing in chat again.
I don't know either, Evan. It just kind of happened there.
Okay, yeah, you're OP'd, so you should be able to post link now.
Yay! Get your ass on OP.
Hey, what, Evan?
So. Hey. There we go. So there is the A-list's link. And now let's get into... we could talk about cosmetics because the Halo Skull, because no one really chimed in on it, was a pre-order bonus. And it was one of the most coveted items back in Halo 2 because only developers from Bungie or Bungie employees had it. So you had to pre-order Halo 3 in order to get the Flaming Skull Visor, basically.
Did not care.
So, I mean, it's that I just don't like it when they lock content behind pre-orders, especially when it's like exclusive content that people want.
Yeah.
So
when it's stuff like that you can only get, when it comes to certain developers too, like when Halo, if they say, oh yeah, only our employees have that, you could bet they really mean only our employees have that.
Mm-hmm.
Unlike where, you know, everybody else is just like, oh yeah, it's going to be exclusive for people who pre-order. And then like 2 months later, they release it for like a paid thing for everybody else. It's like, you know, if it's something that makes you feel special and actually keeps you special, that's one thing. But if it's something that they're just going to release for another, you know, $2 or something down the road, it's just like, I don't need to pre-order anything. I might not even have the game in another 2 months when they put that out. I don't know.
But for me, I just don't like the Deus Ex is like, yeah, we're going to change the release date depending on how many people pre-order. And I'm like, that's so shady. That's so shady. And I just don't like it. The thing that kind of gets me with this is what's going to happen for later games like Final Fantasy 15 or Kingdom Hearts 3. Are we going to get exclusive worlds locked out of it? And before we go on, Ayla, you're getting blurry as heck. So your
out of focus.
Out of focus. Out of focus.
Let me pull my shit up.
But
There she is. Now she's in focus.
But anyways, that's what more worries me is for later games, are we going to get content locked out of Kingdom Hearts 3?
No.
Yes, I think we will. Because if you can pull it with Deus Ex, they can pull it with Kingdom Hearts 3.
Not to that extent, though. Are you sure? Like, maybe certain costumes or something like that, but I wouldn't see, like, entire worlds. Because they've never done any... In Kingdom Hearts games in the past, they've almost never done anything like that. There's been no DLC for Kingdom Hearts games. There has been, you know, nothing extra for pre-orders unless it was, like, a collector's book or something. It was always something physical. It was never anything digital.
Oh, but that's true of Deus Ex as well. But... with this new one, they've locked missions out of on pre-order. And a certain number of pre-order has to get made before you get those missions. What I think would be interesting or equivalent would be, why don't you play a few missions as Riku? As you go through the world and you kind of go and you play as the villain or as a side character going through the same world and with a different narrative to kind of piece together... Go ahead.
I would say we're looking at two very different audiences for who they're targeting with Kingdom Hearts and who they're going to be targeting with Deus Ex. And usually, and just from a marketing standpoint, you're not going to do that same thing to the Kingdom Hearts. The Kingdom Hearts is actually going to be at a slightly younger age range. We're looking at late teens to late 20s, the people who grew up with it, and the people who are entering it now, first discovering Final Fantasy, still enjoying Disney characters, things like that. My children are going to be interested in playing Kingdom Hearts. The thing you're more likely to see with that is more of what you would see on like a mobile game where they're like, hey, if you do this, unlock this special blue skin for your Keyblade. I think we're less likely to see content be put behind a paywall or a pre-order wall as more as we are going to see something like, hey, reorder it and you're going to get this, you know, shiny Disney Keyblade. It's not going to be something that any of us are going to care about losing, except maybe Evan.
Yeah, well, for
except
me...
Except maybe me, yes.
I probably will too, because by that point I will have played through Kingdom Hearts for Kingdom Hearts 3 for the channel, because pretty much I do all JRPGs now. So, you know, like, it's just how it is. And action RPGs, and oh my gosh. Let me just say,
RPGs.
I can't wait for Kingdom Hearts 3. Like, I am like, oh. I love the concept of it.
December. Keep the dream alive.
Speaking of, December. Dream alive. Next year.
I already know it's not going to happen, but I can dream. Make it magical. I'm just saying.
Yep.
You know.
Speaking of magical.
At earliest spring. I would say.
Yeah, right when they're releasing Deus Ex, February 23rd.
No, I'm thinking like April. I'm thinking like April.
I don't think we'll see an April release of anything major other than some like Nintendo craziness because Nintendo doesn't pay attention to marketing.
The thing with Kingdom Hearts is weird because it's not like COD or Halo where they're always released during the fall months because of Christmas. Every Kingdom Hearts game has had a different release date. Heck, the last one, 365 Days, I think came out in July. So it's like, it's not like they have a set release schedule. Sometimes they come out in the fall. Sometimes they come out in like the spring. Sometimes they come out in the summer. Like, I'm pretty sure there's a Kingdom Hearts game that has come out in every season. You know, like you can never really place when that game is going to come out. But to be honest, if you look at the release date, I've put way too much research into this, by the way. If you look at the release dates for their games... and be like, okay, well, they spent about this much time making this game and this game and this game. You can say, be like, oh, okay, so the last one was released sort of like later in the summer. Maybe they could do it towards fall. But seeing that this has already been in development for almost like 4 years, you know, waiting till next spring may has that effect where it might, you know, the hype might die down a bit and people might forget about it. Now the hype is fresh because they're just going to, you know, announce release date in November, bringing it out in like March or April. People still remember. It's like Kingdom Hearts. You know, by that time, you know, by then the hype of the November announcement, whatever the new trailer is going to be, whatever the new announcements are when it comes to worlds, you know, people might forget if they wait another year, you know, till next November to release the game. I say spring is highly plausible.
Yeah, I think, well, I think we're going to see, well, actually could be, because Square said this. They were very, very surprised that Bravery Default and Fire Emblem Awakening, back when they released in the March timeframe, really took off. Because traditionally, those are not months you release your game. Okay, like March, April, those are terrible sales times for whatever reason. So no games release. But Fire Emblem Awakening comes out, and it shifts more units than pretty much anything on the Nintendo 3DS thus far. And then Bravery Default comes out, and it outsold freaking Shin Megami Tensei. Like no one saw that coming, you know? So, that's what surprised me is it seems like RPGs are going to be released near the February, March, April time frame now, because to be honest, JRPGs are summer games. Like when people have time to play games, that's when they like to jump into JRPGs. So I think
And that's what I'm saying. I think, you know, late April, maybe early May or something like that, I think that's a good time to release an RPG like Kingdom Hearts, because that's when people are getting to the end of their semesters in college, depending on where you are. School's almost done. That's, you know, that's a good location. Especially like A-List said, if it's going to be marketed to primarily somewhat younger people, that's a prime date for them around that general area.
Yep.
So that's another reason why, you know, I was thinking, you know, that's a good time, because summer, long RPG like Kingdom Hearts, which they have said it's going to be bigger. Most of the worlds aren't going to be returning worlds. They're going to be absolutely new worlds, and they're going to be big and expansive, which is going to be great. So it's like, yeah, it gives people time to explore and do all that sorts of stuff. So another reason
why. I want Belle back.
You want Belle?
I want Belle back.
They've done Beauty and the Beast at least in two games, haven't they?
I know, yes. She's my favorite.
They've already said that most of the worlds are not, most of the Disney worlds are not going to be returning, including Halloween Town, and
which kind of sucks.
It kind of sucks, but I also sort of understand why. Halloween Town has been one of those that has been literally in every Kingdom Hearts game.
There's a reason.
They've done everything they've had to do with that. Well, I feel like the reason that they took a lot of those worlds out is because they're sort of doing worlds differently now.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, that's not confirmed, but I feel like the way the story's going to be going in the, you know, in the future of how this is going to go, because they've already confirmed that this is not going to be the last Kingdom Hearts game. There's going to be more Kingdom Hearts games, and it's still going to be Sora as the main protagonist. But I feel like, you know, maybe some of those worlds could sort of return. A lot of people have speculated, well, maybe you can have some of those returning worlds returns as summons rather than actually going back to their worlds and stuff like that. But when you go to the new, well, you have to understand, since the last major Kingdom Hearts game, there has been several new Disney movies that have come out that they could do stuff with, Big Hero 6. So, you know, like, there's tons of new stuff that they could build on rather than all of the, you know, old school Disney stuff that everybody knows about and loves. You know, I think,
Over in the comments, Prime Rex mentioned he would love to see a Wreck-It Ralph world.
Yeah.
Who else would love to go racing in the freaking Candy World? I would love that.
Yes.
Oh, my God. Build your own cart, like the old gummy system.
Build a cart. Yes. Yes.
Gummy carts. Let's do this.
That's what I said. It was
It wouldn't even be gummy carts. It would be candy. You can build your own candy cart, like in the factory.
Yes.
And that's actually how you got around the world.
Yes.
You just run around the world. You could drive around the world in your little candy cart. That would be so good. That would be great. I like
it. Life goals.
They should have made that. That should have been the Wreck-It Ralph game. Seriously. Like, I would have bought
movie
that.
Games aren't good.
It was on the internet. I played all the Wreck-It Ralph games with my children. There was a Fix-It Felix game. There was a candy racing game. And there was also, oh my God, I forget the name.
Okay.
But I mean,
the butt game. You could play them on the internet. Yeah. You actually could play them on a browser game.
Dang. But I mean, like a AAA full release, like let's GTA 5 this stuff.
with GTA like, Wreck-It Ralph with DLC. Like
open
I'm
world.
Sure there's a mod for that for GTA 5.
If there's not, there needs to be.
But, I know, right?
But that's what I mean, is just that big kind of AAA development where there's like several game worlds you can go into. And that should have been the Wreck-It Ralph game, and that was a missed opportunity in my eyes. Instead of the like random iOS or the Android games, which were good, like don't get me wrong, I like the Android and the mobile games, but it your princess was in another castle, in other words. Like it just wasn't what I was looking for when yeah. I saw the game world. Wow, man, we have gotten way
are nowhere near what we were planning on talking about.
No, nope.
Kingdom Hearts is worth speculating.
Yes, I know, so, right?
Yep.
Just so.
Evan has hijacked the podcast with Kingdom.
I'm sorry.
Hearts.
Well, that's fine. But hold on, I was not the cause of that conversation. Alias was the one who's like, Prime Rex said Wreck-It Ralph, and then we were all like, yes, they should have candy cards. Ah!
That's right.
I regret nothing. I regret absolutely nothing.
I don't regret anything either. I had that. You guys gave me that idea. That's a great idea. Candy carts get around the world. You don't even need to run around with. That's. Oh, you could do drive-bys with the Keyblade on like. You could get in your candy cart, and it could be like, you know, like Legend of Zelda on the horse. He could just ride by, you know, just clothesline him with his Keyblade as he drives by. Perfect.
We're gonna wreck all these candy mailboxes. Come on, boom!
You could create a candy motorcycle, and you could have two sidecars on the side for Donald and Goofy. Yes.
Oh yeah! My gosh.
I like this idea.
Oh my word.
Liking it. I'm gonna submit this as a final. Look, I'm gonna email, this world in there, and it better have candy carts with where I can drive by Heartless with my Keyblade. That's all I want.
Oh, you know what's another thing that I can talk about? And I was like, I want Wreck-It Ralph in Smash. So this is my line of thought here. I want Wreck-It Ralph in Smash. Oh, Smash news. Yes, someone got an amiibo over the weekend, and it's a game that I dearly love.
Yes.
And I forgot to mention it on news when we were talking about news. Actually, we didn't cover news. We've just been talking. But Shovel Knight got an amiibo. Like, what? Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
They did?
Yeah, Shovel Knight's got his own amiibo now.
Yep, Shovel Knight has his own amiibo, and he unlocks two-player mode in Shovel Knight. So you put the amiibo on, and then, bam, you can play as two. You can go through it on co-op, as well as Plague of Shadows, I think is the DLC pack. Got a whole lot more footage.
And they're just milking those things.
Oh my gosh, but Plague of Shadows is free to play, or free if you own the game, so.
I know, but you still gotta pay for the amiibo, though.
Oh yeah, I mean, I'll play about the friggin' amiibo, so I don't care.
Wait, like, is it on sale, or did they just announce
it? No, they announced it, so.
Okay, because I was like, man, I feel like I need to buy that even though I've never played the game.
I need to buy that too, but that's because I actually play Shovel Knight.
Speaking of amiibo, I had to throw this out there, and I'm very proud that I went into GameStop when I did, because I have connections there. They told me they have the end of September, they have a 3-pack of all the retro characters coming out, like Duck Hunt Dog, Mr. Game & Watch, and whatever the other one was. I forget Rob, thank you. Okay. They're coming in a 3-pack. They're not coming single packs that I know of. They're coming in a 3-pack. And like each store only got a certain amount of ones. Yeah. And I went in the day before to buy something, and they said, dude, you got to come back tomorrow when this goes on pre-order, because that's all they're going to send us is pre-orders for this. I totally pre-ordered that. I feel special because I'll be one of 8 people in my entire town that will have one of those.
So I'm going to talk about a little bit about amiibos, because I want to show the camera.
Hold on. Let me just
see this. I got this day one because I care about Fire Emblem.
We can't see you. Remember?
You have to understand that
Twitch can see it, and this is a Twitch comment. Okay.
Yeah.
I could care less about what content amiibos. It's my Marth copy. Add to actual games. I have never been able to find a physical representation of these games beforehand for less than $60. Okay? And I can't afford spending $60 on fluff. Okay? I can show my pride in my favorite games because I love these games growing up for $13. I could care less what they add. And speaking of which, I am so freaking pumped for just the abilities in Mario Maker, which releases this week, and hopefully I'll get it for my birthday next week. Lots of birthday swag. But I'm excited to play like the Mario levels as like Mega Man 8-bit and like Pac-Man 8-bit and like Kirby 8-bit and all these. Go ahead.
You can't find these. You have Marth, but you do not have these. I win. Although I'm still very jealous of your Marth. Screw you, by the way. I looked for a Marth. Can't get one now. Sorry, oh. I get very prejudiced when it comes to people who have a Marth, and I don't.
Sorry, Devious. There's no swearing in chat, so you got some bovine justice. You should be... you should just be simply... muted for our for 600 seconds. So, but
you said bad words.
There's no cursing in chat. You should probably tell me of all people that ahead of time before we start this.
Yeah.
I know, right?
Here
I'm gonna give myself permaband.
Yeah. Well, no, I'll unban. There's people that I don't care if they do it. Like Devious has been around a while, so I don't really care.
Yeah. Devious has been timed out 4 times.
Yep. So, but like I don't mind if Devious does it, but I try to hold them up to the camera.
Look, okay, my rare ones that I have.
BRB, while you're doing that.
Okay.
I have a little Mac. In fact, I have 2 little Macs. One's over on my shelf. I wanted one to train, and I wanted one to keep in a box, so I have 2 little Macs. I also have a Wii Fit Trainer. That was one of the first rare ones, besides Marth, the Villager, and this one. And then the one that was the GameStop exclusive, which you could is the Shulk. So there. I have other
my
ones.
Amiibos?
I have some custom painted ones.
My amiibos. Well, I have no amiibos.
That's fine. I'm just saying, like, the reason why I own amiibos is not because of what they do in the game. Like, I want the physical, like, sculpture, if that makes sense.
I also have them.
I get that. Like, I keep a little toy Yoshi by my desk.
Yeah. See? So, and that's the same thing is...
I wanted the Yoshi.
I want the Yoshi Yarn amiibo, too.
Also have that one.
I mean, he is very cute.
Just saying.
But again, they are... I can understand it, but for me, like... They were the first, like, Nintendo-licensed things that actually looked decent that weren't, like, $500 to buy.
I feel like they've been getting better as they make more. Like, the first ones looked okay, but the more series that they keep coming out with, the newer ones look better, I think, than the older ones do.
Yeah. And... I think it's just getting better and better. And I don't want to introduce a new topic with A-List being gone.
I know.
I can show you more of my amiibos. No, I have custom
let's go ahead ones. And just chat a little bit about Mario Maker since it is released. So are you planning...
Did it release? I must have missed that.
Well, it's releasing tomorrow, I believe. No, oh, September 6th. So,
So that's Sunday.
Different than just released.
Yeah. Well, yeah, it is different than just released. My apologies.
You liar.
I am a liar head. Dirty liar. But, I'm really looking forward to that game. And I'll be twitching it because, you know, nothing says quality content like watching me hours and hours on end deciding where to place blocks on a screen. Like,
oh no! See, I won't be someone who will create in that game. I will be the one that plays all the creations of other people in that game. That's gonna be me.
That's what I'm gonna do is be like, hey guys, I'm playing Mario Maker. Send me your maps, and I'll play through them live on stream. So all that type of thing. So.
Infinite replayability. Way to go, Nintendo.
Yes, and that's exactly what I wanted with Mario Maker. So, and I'm just happy that. Things are happening, and that Nintendo's actually releasing games and supporting a platform that's failing. Because there's other companies out there, Vita, when their platform fails, that they cut all support. And actually, from what I heard, and I haven't been able to confirm this, Sony out of E3 said that they're no longer supporting the Vita. Like, they're just not going to make anything. Like, people can make stuff for the Vita, but they're not going to try to market it anymore. Which kind of makes sense, considering what's been going on. But that thing is, like, an otaku weeb machine, man. Like, I want to pick it up just for the Animu games.
Yeah, are you into Animu games? Because that's all that's on the Vita.
Do you want to touch some butts? Do you want to touch some anime boots? Like, seriously, the Animu butts in that game, in that on that platform are for real. Like,
Because I feel like there isn't any, like, anime-type games or, like, JRPGs that I've been interested in lately. I feel like I should get a Vita just so I can play all of them.
Well,
it's like, that's what you do it on.
There's a heck ton coming out right now for specifically, like, in the next few months, it's, like, JRPG, like,
heaven.
Ridiculousness with, yep. like, Xenoblade Chronicles X, Persona 5, Shin Megami Tensei X Fire Emblem.
I thought that wasn't coming out till next year.
No, it's January. So, I mean, it is next year, but it's early. So,
okay.
Yeah.
That's right after Christmas. All right, yeah, cool.
Yep, and there's, I mean, watch this. The RPG that I'm pumped about is October 23rd. Guild Wars 2 Heart of Thorns. So let's transition into an actual topic we're supposed to talk about.
Okay. All right.
So, overrated.
Chat while they go on a rant.
Yep. Guild Wars 2 Heart of Thorns got a release date this PAX Prime, which is October 23rd. And the big news is that if you haven't played Guild Wars, you can. Except, you can't do much in the game. Well, you can play the game, but a lot of the conveniences of the game have been stripped away. You can play the game for free now. 2 character slots, 3 bags, limited use of the auction hall, only on select items, no daily rewards, which kind of sucks because that's the primary
way really sucks.
You can level. And pretty much you can... you can experience Guild Wars 2, and you can...
Doesn't sound like the full experience of Guild Wars 2.
It's an extended trial, really.
Yes, you can get the level 80, but the convenience of getting there really sucks. Because even me, like, I save up gold and buy 5 or 6 bag slots on all my characters... and that's another thing you can't do. You can't convert gold to, or from gold to gems. You can buy gems and convert it to gold, but in Guild Wars 2, you can spend in-game currency to buy premium currency, which is a awesome feature. Free accounts can't do that. They can sell, real money items for gold or gold in-game. And that's how Guild Wars gets around botters, but it's, I mean, it's the full game. But you just have restrictions on your account. Now, I will say that I am excited for this because if there's one thing I want to do is share the experience of Guild Wars 2 with other people because I really think it is a revolutionary MMO. And it's one of the things...
That's high praise.
It is. It's one of my favorite games of all time. And it takes away the problems of the MMO genre... And adds some more, but it gets rid of all of my major complaints in an MMO. Well, it's like in-game content.
Gets rid of some,
but
it adds some.
Yeah. But it really isn't that bad.
Well, it isn't, because the things I complain about are you're really focused on in-group content is about playing off other people's combos, okay? Like combo fields. 99% of the user base does not understand this whatsoever, okay? Like, if you talk about what's a blast finisher and a pug, or a random group, for those of the uninitiated in the MMO world, like, they will barely know what stacking is, which is basically piling in one place so all your melee attacks hit all the largest group of enemy. And getting a good stack is hard to in Guild Wars 2 already. Now add free-to-play players that have even less investment in the game, and dungeoneering is going to be hard. From what I remember, was LFG, looking for groups restricted. You can't actually do looking for group, or the dungeon finder, with the free-to-play account. So you're going to have to be in map chat, but you can't speak in map chat as a free-to-play user.
I don't know what that is.
Okay, so basically...
Evan's completely lost.
And in Guild Wars 2, you have an LFG, which is looking for group, button, pretty much, where you can post that you're looking for a group, or you can see other people's groups, their composition, their levels, and what, kind of like a blurb, like a Twitter blurb of like what their goal is, you know, like all three paths, full clear, you know, like that type of thing, speed clear, blah, blah, blah. So you know what you're getting into when you join the group. Free-to-play accounts cannot use this feature. And they cannot, most people communicate when they're in a zone by typing slash map. Okay. And it goes to everyone who's in the zone. Free-to-play accounts cannot do that. They can only do local, and you cannot whisper someone that hasn't whispered you beforehand.
So what this sounds like to me is it's an MMO that, while it goes free-to-play, that strips all the features of an actual MMO out of the game, but they go free-to-play to try to get you to play the game and spend money. I feel like that's counterintuitive at this point. If they take out all the things that make the game convenient to play, you know, because you play an MMO for the experience of playing with other people and, you know, working together to get stuff done.
Yeah.
But from what it sounds like to you, they took out all that features. What's the point of playing the game? People like me who doesn't know a friend like you that could teach me stuff.
Yeah.
If they just go into this blind and be like, I don't know what any of that is. Well, you're not going to because you can't use it. Ha ha. You know.
Maybe I'm a dinosaur here, but once upon a time, we all went into a game by ourselves, made friends, joined a guild, and learned the game that way. Well, that's what I mean. I had no idea what happened to Kithacore Forest at night, but I sure as heck found out on my own. So, I don't know.
Quit your whining, noob.
They don't want you to keep playing the game for free. They want you to get in the world and go, I kind of like this character. I'm going to buy the game. They don't want you to enjoy your free account enough that you keep playing for free. Just enjoy it enough that you want to invest in the game. It's a good marketing ploy, but I don't think we should look at it as anything more than that. It's an extended trial. It's like getting a 20-day free card from a friend and getting to go into the game and try it out. You see it all the time.
I understand that, but I'm just saying, like, for me, if I didn't know any of this stuff beforehand and be like, oh, well, Chris talks about Guild Wars 2 a lot, it's free to play, maybe I'll try it. And I just went in blind trying to, you know, figure stuff out, I would have been like, well, I can't use any of this. What's the point? Yeah. You know, for me, I would be more frustrated because I can't figure out that I would have to pay to figure out all this stuff.
Yeah.
Rather than, because, like, what happens if I get in there and I don't like it? I feel like, for me, the point of a free trial is to show off your game so that they would want to pay for it, not take out all of the features that makes the game great first and then try to make them pay for it. That's sort of what I'm trying to get at. And yeah, you're right. At one point, we all went into a game as single player, but I feel like that's not an MMO. An MMO, you're meant to try and play with other people.
Well, they don't inhibit that in Guild Wars 2. What they inhibit is your bank slot space and very key features. And Guild Wars 2 is buy-to-play, okay? $50 one time gets you the in-game expansion, new classes for each of the 8 classes, full account unlock. You know, you get your bag spaces, everything gets unlocked for you. $50 one time, okay?
Yep.
That's
not bad.
Well, that's what I mean. It's a good model in my eyes. It's consumer-friendly because I know you're not like, oh, man, I'm not gonna play this, blah, 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 you know? We're not going to play this because of the inconvenience, but you can, it's just a taste. That's what it's supposed to be. Rather than locking the core content behind a paywall to for the people that haven't even tried. And I guarantee you try Guild Wars 2 Combat and it is really refreshing. Like, it is really fun to play on an action MMO type of perspective. So, I mean, Anna's played it, the only other person here that's played it. And she likes it from what I can tell, so.
Oh, yeah.
How long does it get to max
really
level?
To get back in.
It takes around 40 hours, probably, depending on what you do. So.
Yeah.
But it's all fun content leveling up.
It's really long.
Yeah.
Please. Like,
getting up to max isn't that bad. No, and a lot of stuff unlocks before you get there.
Yeah. There was a time where I wouldn't even sneeze at 40 hours. This is how much my gaming time is, how much my gaming preferences has changed. Back when I was in high school and college, 40 hours, nothing. I could get that done.
Yeah, I'm there too.
Yeah.
Over a weekend, but now it's just like, by the time I even put in, like, I would probably put in half of that time and just not be interested anymore. I have a very, very short attention span when it comes to that kind of stuff. Yeah, exactly.
Speaking of squirrels, check out my Squirtopia video.
No, finale. No, no squirrels. No.
It's okay.
Nope, I'm good. I might watch that one.
It's the worst. It is the worst level of all time. 5-7. The whole freaking thing is made up of explosive blocks. The whole level. Whole level is explosive blocks. It is the worst.
No.
Watch it. It's hilarious. I get to the very last jump. Nope. Just not even going to say it.
Spoilers.
Nope. Just watch it. It's great. So it's probably my best Let's Play. I will say that. So.
No spoiler. Go watch.
Yep. So now the what I was saying is I get what you mean. Like, there is a limited amount of time we have as content creators.
Yeah.
That, you know, especially like as our channels grow, we're getting more and more pressed on spending time. There's even like indie games that I've gotten review keys for that, you know, say don't even require me to do a review. They just want me to stream the game, and I'm just thinking about streaming the game because that's 10 times easier than doing a 20 minutes a game on it. Putting all that production value and where I can get some coverage out on the game, but not like take 10 hours of shooting a review for it and then even longer than that in editing. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And these are streams that are games that are better streamed. And that type of thing. I can get that. 40 hours is a lot. But honestly, Guild Wars 2 has one of the best questing and best story environments, like, out of any MMOs I have ever played.
It doesn't feel like a chore at all.
Yeah, and that's what I mean is, when you this is what people hated. When you get the max level, there's nothing new to do, because you've already been doing the end game the whole time. The process of playing Guild Wars is in of itself the end game, okay? So if you don't like leveling up or your process of leveling up, then you had nothing to really look forward to besides dungeons, which once you do dungeons, although like the 10 dungeons have 4 paths each, Era has 5, but that's beside the point. And once you play through the 41 dungeons, there's not much left to do as far as just farm dungeons or go to PvP or PvE zones that are all dynamic all the time, like Silver Waste, which always has something going on, or things like that. But in the new game, they're adding raids. So that got announced. That was leaked on Reddit beforehand, but it was officially announced at Prime that Guild Wars 2 is adding raids, like legit raids. And to Guild Wars 2, which I'm pumped about. But I don't really have time for raids, like, anymore. I don't have that, like...
Who's got time for raids anymore?
It's a little bit different because I'm a content creator now, and I can be like, hey, guys, it's raid night on, you know, Twitch, you know, let's do this. But 4 hours is a lot of time for me to devote to anything. Like, this straight up. I mean, that's about how much time I spend when I review an indie game when I play through it. So that's a review for me, you know? Like,
yep.
I don't know. See, like,
I find that, like, if I had the time, like, all day, like, if my YouTube was my job, which it's not, I would be able to play through more games and finish things, but... Now that it's like, no, I have like 2 days off a week. The rest of it is spent at an actual job, 40 to 50 hours a week, making money. And those 2 days are spent actually playing games and, you know, actually making videos. Because when it comes to that sort of stuff, it's like I have to pick and choose. Like, that's why I do mainly Let's Plays, which kind of, you know, I didn't want to be a Let's Play channel. in the beginning, but I've become one because I don't really have time to do too much edited content, which is why I wanted to do like beginner's luck at least once a week. Now I just sort of release it when they get done, because half the time, depending on the game, that could take, you know, 2 hours to edit, or that could take 6-8 hours to edit. You know, it's like, and when I get home from work, it's just like, let's just stream a game. It's just easier.
Yeah.
Like, I'm just tired.
Well, and that's you what know? I really like doing things on Twitch. When we do get people to watch us, it's a lot more fun than doing YouTube work. Like, it just, it feels better, unless you're one of these two ladies to the right. Being a female streamer really sucks.
Being a female streamer is wonderful. They're compliments. Even if they're dirty compliments, they're still compliments.
Well, no, in Anna's case, it's because...
Not so much.
Because it was, you know, I don't...
I wish I got dirty compliments.
Just say it.
Well, I don't like this because I don't see you this way, okay? When
I know you don't, but
Anna
it's okay.
is a larger lady, okay? And of course, 99% of the comments, whether it's Anna streaming, me streaming, or Evan streaming, it's always, oh my gosh, fat American. Like,
yep, I could see that.
I mean, and that's okay. Like, I don't mind it, but to me, it's like when I see, I don't mind when people call me fat American because. Whatever. I don't really mind. But when people call my friends that, I get defensive. Okay? Like, I'm like, who are you to say this? And you're probably like 120 pounds overweight, living in your mom's basement, writing on Twitch. You know, let's be honest here. You know, we're all gamers here. We all kind of live this way. So, whether we live with our parents and or I dream broadcasting... to from my basement. So
I don't know about you guys, because I'm not always around for you guys' streams a lot. I don't really get a lot too much of that at all. I don't mean to like say, you know, try to make myself look better, but it's like I don't, when it comes to like, so I've had more trolls come in and just try to make fun of like me playing the game rather than like what I look like. To be honest, half the time my screen caps up in the screen, it's like it's small, it's like you can't even tell for me. I mean if somebody does for me, I was just like, yeah, so what, you know, I just sort of embrace it. Not that it's like, you know, good to be a fluffy person, but it's like it's like, you know what, yeah, just embrace it. Yeah.
Speaking of just embracing things.
Just embracing things. What are we
doing? How about that Halo 5 trailer?
Can I embrace a what?
How about the Halo 5 trailer?
Yeah.
8 billion.
Yes.
I took away from the trailer. Oh my god, Nathan Fillion.
I don't mean to. Oh my gosh, Nathan Fillion.
That was
Yeah. Yep.
Captain Hammer.
So yeah, exactly. And the hammer.
You know what would have been great?
The fist or not the hammer.
You know what would have been really, really just like a really cool callback is if, you know how like on your armor you can make your own emblem? I feel like on Nathan Fillion's armor somewhere he should have had like the Captain Hammer symbol.
Oh my somewhere gosh. On his... yes.
I feel like that should have been his symbol.
No, Easter egg. You know what he should have had on there? Here's his look behind me. That's what he should have had on there.
Yes.
Yep. Yes. So you should. Well, it actually would be really funny if in like Warzone, I really hope they do this, but I know it's not going to happen. But instead of a Pelican drop, you could have like a Serenity, our Firefly class drop, come in and drop it if you're squatted.
Yes.
I would freaking buy that DLC. You want to talk cosmetic DLC that I'll throw money at? Holy crap.
There you go.
Hate Firefly DLC. Yep. That's all you got to do.
Pretty much.
Do you want the Jade size drop and you get like an OP spanker that's named Vera? Yes. Yes, I do. That's what you need.
I would pay so much money to have like an orange hat on a Spartan that's like the Jane hat.
My mom made this.
Yep, that's exactly what you need. That's going to be, you know what? We just gave him ideas. Exclusive pre-order. Damn it.
God, darn it. Yep, so, but what I want to talk about is that everyone that's watched the trailer has this kind of split reaction to it. half the people are like, oh my gosh, this is how Spartans are supposed to be. All the other people are like, oh, well, Marvel stealing jerks at 343. So, what's your guys' reaction to this other than LOL Nathan Fillion? So
there's another reaction to be had. OMG Nathan Fillion? I know, right?
I will say I want Castle
to be
back.
How about them? How about that motion capture and that facial technology? Because those graphics make Nathan Fillion really look like Nathan Fillion. I'm just saying.
I know, right?
Doesn't Nathan Fillion look just like Nathan Fillion? It's great.
And Chris is looking at us like, shut up, fangirl!
About Nathan Fillion!
No, because I'm a fan of Nathan Fillion. I love Nathan Fillion every freaking thing he does. So, like, I don't know actors and actresses, but I know Nathan Fillion. So I will say that.
I think, you know, here's my overly nerd side. Like, you and I both were thinking before the podcast, Chris, this is closer to what you, like, read in the books. This is closer to the overall Halo universe. I don't necessarily see it as a negative thing.
Yeah. And so, same. In case you guys didn't know, the Spartans go ham on the Spartan Force, one of the best choreographed action sequences I've ever seen in any form of media. Okay, it goes down in the Halo exclusive level gameplay, whatever release that just happened, Spartans really kicked the crap out of pretty much the Covenant. And I'm like, that is how Spartans are supposed to be. So, because in the games, you take down a squad and yes, you're okay, whatever. But you're not like sprinting all the time and you're not like agility. Like these guys just blow through everything. So, I just want Halo 5. I want it so bad. I'm freaking month. 1 month till Halo 5. So,
guess it is one. More like two-ish. But, yeah.
Well, yeah, it's 56 days. So, yep, I'm not a nerd at all. So.
But them Nathan Fillion graphics. So
yeah, the Nathan Fillion.
I know.
I will say that we're going to have a podcast. Well, I don't know. Me and Evan will have like a nerd talk thing probably on one of our streams discussing which of the Lady Spartans is our waifu after.
No. No, not the waifu. Just her armor. Yep, just her. I don't know about the woman yet. I have no idea who she even is.
Well, after
but
we
her
play
armor
the game, that's
looks
what I'm talking
awesome.
About. Is which one's more awesome? Or
I don't look.
Blue
I just
or
want a life-size version of that armor. I don't. You could keep the boobs on it if you want. Just I just want the armor. I mean, honestly, mine could probably fit in there. It would be fine, to be honest.
Oh my god!
It would probably work out in the end because that way I won't have to lose weight.
I need it, man. I need the support to get around the armor.
It makes sense. To me now. It's great.
Oh jeez. So yep. Well, now if I ever get Spartan forearmor, I need some support. So,
amen.
Oh gosh, the things we do on the podcast. So, anyways, that's loving pretty. It. I think that's all the news topics I want to talk about.
I have one.
Okay, let's talk.
MMOs. So I'm gonna go all wow on you guys again today. Okay. They added flying to Warlords of Draenor, and they added a new PvP system called Mercenary System, which is. If, say, you're on a very horde-controlled server, you play Alliance, you're getting a lot of problems with queuing, where you can't get into a battleground because your side has too much waiting, you can now play as a mercenary for the other team. So what? You will actually race change into the corresponding one, so the one that we know is obvious is, you know, you're going to get the Worgen and the Goblins. You'll switch to that corresponding race and actually play for the other side so that you don't have to wait forever and can still go honor farming.
Oh, my
so
gosh.
So that is a very cool system for them to add.
That is a really cool system. But, like, what do trolls turn into? Are undead? That's what I want to know. Like, because, like, I get Draenei are, like, probably the Tauren. Like,
Draenei and Blood Elves.
They
came out at the same time.
Yep.
It's the same thing that you would get with the Orb of Deception. So anything that you would have transmogged to with the Orb of Deception before is what you'll turn into now.
Okay.
I'm guessing. I haven't gotten into the game to find out.
Oh, okay. So that's the type of thing that I'm like, oh my gosh, wow. So, someone's messaged me on the Twitters. Or not Twitters, but
I'm not talking to you. No, keep going. I'm just talking to Anna.
Oh, okay.
Me and Anne are having our own chat while you guys geek out about that.
Oh, okay.
That's fine. Thought it was worth mentioning today because that's the first time I've seen that in an MMO. Honestly, I don't know of any other MMO that has that sort of system
in
place.
No, there's none. And that's... Okay, so basically, if in WoW, it's especially prevalent that...
Wow.
There's two factions, okay? Horde and Alliance. And this is... I'm just breaking it down for the noob here. And when you join a server...
Hi, Anna.
It's...
Hi, Evan.
It's going to be 90% controlled by one of the two factions, because God forbid there be an actual balanced server in WoW, and people try to actually balance the game. But no, 90% of the servers on WoW are pretty much either Horde or Alliance controlled, meaning that the population of the server is 80% or higher Horde or 80% or higher Alliance, meaning that getting into PvP to get the mandatory PvP armor to get higher in PvP arenas and get win the cash money prizes in the WoWs is extremely hard.
The WoWs.
Because you can't really find a match for 5-10 minutes because there ain't nobody that's going to play against you. So, that kind of goes.
And I'm kind of a PvP whore, so it's a big deal to me, because in any game that I play, even if I were playing Guild Wars with you guys, that was what I would spend all my time doing is PvP.
And PvP in Guild Wars 2 will eat you alive unless you don't know what you're doing. So that's one of
those. Okay, I don't think they could finish all of me. It's fine.
Well, I can't wait for Evan to try this game. I'll bring him into PvP. First thief he goes against, or Mesmer, they'll be like, there are 9 copies of this person on screen. Which one do I press? Press all the buttons.
I will go into it specifically to be your meat shield. That's it. That's all I'm going to be.
I'm going to build you all tank, man.
Look.
All tank.
Going into...
blocks right in a row, piss off everyone.
Going into an MMO that I've never played before, I am just meat shield. That's all I am. Yep. I am distraction.
Name his character Meat Shield, please.
Seriously,
I will name my character.
Yes. Meat Shield. Yes.
I am Meat Shield.
I am Meat Shield.
Oh jeez.
That's like I am Groot, but I am Meat Shield. I am Meat Shield. I'm gonna have a little bobble doll. That's gonna be like my pet. He's just gonna have a bobble.
Speaking of news out of PAX, this is actually news for a game I don't play, Marvel Ultimate Alliance 2016 or whatever. Or not Marvel Ultimate Alliance, because those are actually good games. But the Marvel 2016 or whatever MMO thing where it's like Diablo clone, whatever. They're getting Symbiote, Rocket Raccoon, and Groot. So, they'll get the Venom skin on it. And I'm like, oh my gosh, it makes me want to play the game. Because Venom is one of my favorite anti-heroes from the... Actually, it's the only anti-hero that I like from... Well, actually, Deadpool. So, from the Marvel universe. But Marvel really has crappy villains. Like, no offense. Like, I don't know how they make the movies as good as they do, because they got, like, zero good villain characters. So... But, they did... They make some good movies. So, but, yep. That's kind of me digging myself into a hole in this day and age. So, yep, that's kind of cool that they are adding new content to an old game and that no one plays. But, out of PAX as well, we got a new controller from Razer, which...
That's crap, apparently.
Which is $150. So, as much as the Elite controller, Razer got announced that they don't want paddles in their game or levers. They want triggers, so.
Don't lick it. Lick it. Oh, no. I was just joking. Yeah, there's the gift.
That was fangirl screenshot ever.
Oh, my gosh. I'm going to screen cap that and put that as your, like, if you ever not show up in a way. Speaking of which, let me
licking my razor.
Yes. Let me see if I can add sources in old OBS. But A-List wasn't going to make it, so I was going to add this as her stuff. Add image, browse. This is going to screw up the stream, but oh well. So that was going to be Alyssa's image for today that I spent like all of 3 minutes in Photoshop. So, or actually paint.net because I'm too cheap. So, yep.
There we go.
If you want to drool over A-list some more chat, go ahead and get that little GIF.
We're going to make A-list desktops out of that. Yep,
pretty much. yep, that was going to be A-list's stuff. So, what have we been playing this week? Anyone play any video games?
Oh my god!
I've been so busy.
Go for Alice. Last week I beat Fallout 1, so I went ahead and did a run of Fallout 2. I'm getting ready to do Fallout Tactics. I'm going to go through all of them before Fallout 4 comes out, so wish me luck. Fallout 3 takes me a long time because I have squirrel syndrome. I also played through that stupid Sakura clicker game because I couldn't resist. And, I'm playing Diablo with my husband and his friends because season 4 just started and I really kind of want that Malthiel mount even though I'm not interested in season 4 at all. I'm going to be going back and playing WoW to prepare for the expansion, and I just finished Mass Effect 1 again this morning because FemShep and Mass Effect 2 is installing.
Oh wow.
Nice. Yeah.
My kids are in school.
I have freedom.
Free time.
Yep. So.
Screw summer. Fall's where it's at.
All right.
All the free time. Once you become an adult.
Yeah. So what about you, Evan, since you have not had internet connection for the past few days?
I've just been playing through the single player of Gears of War Ultimate Edition. I got to say, though, Gears is one of those shooter games that actually has a decently long campaign in it. Longer than COD for the most part, anyway, or at least it feels like it to me anyway. I mean, I've been playing through it for several nights, at least an hour or two, a night.
Yeah.
And I still haven't finished it yet. So it's like, and it came out and I got it on like the day after it came out. So it's like, I've been playing through it for like a week. But some of those nights I did just play like multiplayer, but yeah, I played through, well, what was that game? Velocity X2. I played a bit of that. Mm-hmm. I was going to do an episode of that for beginner's luck. I have things recorded for it. I just haven't done, like, my review-y bits yet. That is a game that's hard to control. It has a very interesting aspect to it, but I feel like some of the mechanics are counterintuitive to how they want you to play. Mm-hmm. They want you to play very, very fast. It's made to be one of those games where you, like, speed run through a bunch of levels and go as fast as you can. But I feel like it's like, especially with the controls, because I was playing with the controller, it's like they want you to keep boosting and go throughout this whole level and just have fast reflexes and teleport. Because one of the main features is that you can teleport between walls and get to all these different areas and hit all these generators to turn off shields and get to next sections and stuff like that. They want you to speed run it, but half the time to get certain things, you have to stop, shoot something sideways, and then you have to speed through it again, teleport over to this way, shoot it, teleport backwards, speed up to this one section, shoot something sideways again, shoot forward, shoot back, and then teleport back to this other section where you just were. It's very confusing. It's fun once you get a hang of it, but it's hard because a lot of the controls that you have to use, like you have to use the right stick to choose a direction which you want to teleport. But you have to hit like X, or like I think it was one of the trigger buttons. Then use that the right stick to in the direction you want to teleport. But then you also have to use that same right stick to fire certain weapons, certain directions, but just kinda not, hard. You know, hit. Yeah, it's sort of the controls don't, I don't, maybe they're better on like keyboard and mouse or something like that. But usually if it's a game like that, because it's a top down, like arcade shoot 'em up type game or like a side scrolling, because it goes back and forth between like those arcade style down, top down, like flight shoot 'em up games.
Yeah.
this side to the side scrolling sort of shoot 'em up type game, because there's these parts where there's these generators that you have to get are inside a certain base. So you sort of dock it, you go into this sort of docking bay area, and it switches to this side-scrolling place where you have to run and gun and shoot, you know, dodge obstacles and things like that. It's sort of the same premise. They want you to go fast, but then there's other mechanics where it's like, oh, well, you can't... I feel like they just should have added a wall jump ability rather than create this grenade, which you have to stop, aim it up, throw it up to the ledge you want to go to, then hit another button and teleport up there, be like, when I could have just been run, jump, 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 and then gotten up there. It's like, really? Like, some of these are just, like I said, some of the mechanics are counterintuitive. It's fun. The story is sort of progresses through each level. They get progressively more challenging, but not too hard as you go along. A lot of the times you die, it's due to because you get your controls confused. And sort of... of it. Yeah.
That would annoy the crud out of me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, say what you want about Squirtopia. There might be a little bit shoddy controls, but at least they were consistently shoddy. You know?
And they make sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, they
They just suck, but they make sense.
They make sense. So,
yeah,
I couldn't do that. So. Bad platforming controls. So,
I feel like that's sort of... Oh, and Mega Man Legacy Collection. Been playing some Mega Man, too. Although I suck at Mega Man. I suck at Mega Man, but I like playing Mega Man, so there. I can only play it a short amount of time. I can be like, I can only die to this one boss like 3 times where I'm just like, why do I even play this game? Why?
That's Mega Man in a nutshell for me, though. It's all like rage quit all the time.
It's weird because I used to be really good at Mega Man back in the day. I used to be able to beat Mega Man games. But now, I seem to have lost it. I don't understand. I can't even go through the first boss and beat him without dying multiple times before
We're getting old.
Yeah, we're just getting suck. We just suck at games now.
Platformers just aren't like they used to be.
Platformers like Squirtopia just aren't what they used to be with the freaking evil explosive levels. Sorry. I can't believe I didn't swear at my finale. So at that point, like that was the biggest test to my family friendly channel or whatever was the last level of Squirtopia, because I will never play that game ever again, other than for 20 minutes of game, because I feel like I should do a 20 minutes of game on it, and I'd be like, yep.
Okay, censorship sounds funny.
Yep. So.
Yeah.
Oh, so I'll go with what I've been playing now, since I was just talking anyways. I've been playing Fairy Fencer F for stream, which no one's been watching. So we've been playing Halo Master Chief Collection together on stream, and we've been
derping that up a lot.
Yeah, I know, right? I've been watching PAX pretty much this last week, 24/7, trying to get topics for the podcast, but PAX didn't give no topics, man. So,
just a heads up, if you have the Master Chief Collection, never play Halo 1 online. Just saying.
Why?
Don't ever play the Halo 1 playlist.
Such a buggy piece of junk. Like,
so many hacks. This is so much hacks.
Garbage all the time.
Like, go watch one of the VODs from the other night.
I'm
going to
make a highlight reel of just all the crap we went through of, like, me shooting someone in the with a shotgun twice from point blank, and, like, them actually registering, but, you know.
Two
like,
shots with pistol, we would die.
Two shots with pistol, which if you've played Halo, it's 3 shots for pistol death. That day was 2-shot day. Then at one point in Halo 3, I shot my rocket launcher at someone during an open...
That was funny. I saw that one. That was
So I shot my rocket launcher in the open, and then I took cover. A second goes by, I don't see my rocket flying out, and then boom, I blow up. So my input had lagged to the point where it was like a full second and a half after. It was like 2 seconds.
Shot a wall.
Yeah, so...
He shot the wall he was covering behind.
Yep.
So, quite funny.
And there was another thing. It was weird. I grabbed the shotgun went through a teleporter and shot a guy on the other side, and I shot myself and committed suicide in Halo 1. I don't know how in the world that happened.
He was moving amazing. So fast, he lagged in front of his own bullets.
That's right.
Easy hack.
So, that's how spawns are supposed to work.
That's right. So.
That's how it's
up. So, yep, Halo 1 and Master Chief Collection is not a good experience.
On Halo 1, I feel like Halo 4 worked just fine, but Halo 1 didn't work very well.
Halo 4 and 2 are good. Halo 3 sucks, but Halo 3 sucked in general. So, as much as you polish a turd, you can't really polish it to be good.
It's still a turd.
Yep.
I feel like you tried and failed that one miserably.
Yep. Well, I was trying to come up with a better...
polish a turd and then...
like, I'm trying to find another way to say this, but it still sucks.
It still sucks. So.
If you put a top hat and a monocle on a turd, then it's just a fancy
turd.
It's not
a turd.
Stop. Put a top hat or a monocle on a mud crab.
For the next podcast, I feel like you need to have a list of, like, a paragraph each for all the things you want to say. It's like all these sayings. It's like, if you go to polish a turd, you gotta
It's just
looked at the paper.
It's hey, just Halo 3 sucks so bad that it blows my mind that I can't put words to it. That, like, everything in that game feels like crap. Like, you shoot people in the head, and because the indicator doesn't say you're hovering over their head, it doesn't count as a headshot. Like, I just don't... No. No. Let's not do that game again, ever. Okay? So, but besides that, I picked up Grandia while it was Grandia 2 on the Steam sale.
So did I, actually. I've
been wanting to play through that because I played the demo disc when it was on Dreamcast. Like, I played the demo for that game 20 times, so I'm super pumped to play through that, because I never have been able to. And then, the next game I want to, well, that's the next thing I'll probably play on the channel, but I've been playing through games that I mostly have been playing for through review, so I'm not, like, super impressed with them. I've been playing a game that's, like, Lumini, that I actually like. I might be in breaking embargo by a day, but I don't care at this point. So you can, you know, whatever. But basically,
small indie devs, they don't pay attention to us.
It's like Flower for the PS4 mixed with Echo the Dolphin. So if you've played either of those games, and there's not much like combat, but it's basically like taking your like Pikmin tribe of fairies through this cave and exploring this world and trying to figure out like what's kind of going on and surviving as you go through. And the more light orbs you collect, the more fairies you can spawn at the next checkpoint. And each of the four fairies, types of fairies, have their own powers. And it's like Metroidvania, where if you find upgrades for your fairies, they can do different things. But it's not half as interesting as I'm making it sound. It's basically a walking simulator with gameplay, a little bit of gameplay. So, of just like seeing different beautiful things. It's pretty to look at and it's fun to explore, but there's not like much intriguing concept. And the puzzles are one stick of your controller, and you should play this on controller for this reason, controls one group of fairies. And you can split off your other group of fairies to do a second group. You can't control more than two groups, and a lot of the puzzles are put one group on this switch and then move your other group while this one is standing on this switch to the other switch. And that is the awesome, awesome puzzling behind the game. So, I haven't been too impressed, but it's a game I would give my daughter and let her play, if that makes sense. So
yeah, I can see that.
So it's been enjoyable, but... The hour I've played it has been too much in my mind. Like, I played it for an hour straight while catching up on your guys' channel stuff. And it was still too much. Like, I watched Level Up Life, and I was like, I just want to watch Level Up Life. I don't want to play this game. So, yep. So, that's kind of what I've been playing. So, but that's the bad thing about doing reviews is you play a lot of things you don't want to play, but you should, you know, for review. So,
mm-hmm.
not all games you want to play, put it that way. So, but anyways, that's kind of what I've been doing is a Fairy Fencer F mixed with Rocket League, mixed with
Rocket League.
Master Chief Collection, mixed with Rare Replay, mixed with Lumini and Leap of Fate. Holy, actually, I've been playing a whole lot of crap. And then I've been wanting to...
More than us!
Yep. So, yeah. I've been wanting to play Grandia 2 since I picked that up on Steam sale. So, yep. So, Anna, you've been too busy to play?
Well, I have got some gaming done, just not as much as I want. For instance, I still got to do Night 6 and FNAF 4, which will be my last night I play. So I got to do that still. I just played some Critter Crunch last night with my brother David because we haven't played it in ages and just wanted to.
Yeah.
Then, of course, you know, Starbound Unstable, it's got the colonization in there, so I want to get back in there and I want to, like, mass take over a planet because I can. And I want to play more Rocket League because I finally have... Don't mind me as I knock over cups. I finally have
a controller.
I decided to go out and get one. And luckily for me, this model is actually made smaller than a normal Xbox controller, so it actually fits my tiny hands.
Nice.
Yay.
Yeah.
Yay.
So I'm gonna be playing Rocket League this week.
Yeah.
At some point.
So if you're on, if I'm on, message me because I can't get enough of that game. So
message us.
You're not.
I will have to.
Yeah. Well, Anna plays during the day, so.
Usually, well, I'm a night person. I'll play at night if I'm not working.
Yeah.
So. It depends. Whenever I have the free time is when I'm in game, pretty much. So, yeah, other than that, I picked up Grandia 2 as well, and I started playing it. I'm not super far in, but I'm really enjoying it. So, I don't know, I just had this weird, like, old school RPG itch I needed scratching, and that game went on sale at the same time, so I was like, playing it!
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So my sponsor for the channel, which is our, in case you guys are new to the podcast, we kind of have a regular, irregular, like Krendor and the co-optional podcast, that's Eternal Fragment, and he's my unofficial sponsor for the channel because he buys me all my games pretty much. he got me Grimrock 1 and 2, our Legend of Grimrock 1 and 2, because I've heard those games are phenomenal, and I told him that Grimrock 2 was on sale at Humble Bundle, and he's like, I'll give you a copy. I'm like, sure. So that would be pretty, that's pretty much also going to be on the, I'm going to play this game this week sometime. Maybe on stream, who knows.
At some point.
Yes. So.
Yes.
I would, this goes off to the comment on chat. I would also love to see a real life Splatoon. And I think if Evan and I lived in the same state, we would definitely do that with a real paintball. Like...
They did kind of do that at the launch party, though. They had a bunch of big YouTubers come out and do it.
It wasn't really the same thing, though.
Yeah.
I mean,
they weren't shooting each other with paper. Well, see, no, what you really need to do is you need to get super soakers.
Yep.
Super there soakers with go. Different colors.
I'm just going to grab a giant paintbrush. Giant paintbrush and just, like, paint your face, Evan. Just one.
He's just going to run up to you with a paint roller.
Yep. It's like one of those giant, like, brushes you use to sweep the floor, but it's just dipped in, like, purple paint. It's just, like, whop. Sub in the face. No, dude, I remember back in the day. You know what I need? I don't know if these still exist. They used to have this giant super soaker rifle that literally had a hose that went to a backpack that you could fill with water.
Seen those. Yes, they still make those.
I had a cousin that used to have one of those, and I always wanted one. I'm pretty sure they don't sell those anymore, but see what I would do? I'd fill that thing up, put like red or pink colored water in there. That's my Splattershot Junior right there. Boom. I win. Just saying. Sorry, we went off on another tangent.
But we're good at that today.
Yes, we are really good at the... We should be called the Tangent Podcast, or the Save Point Online Podcast, where you need to reload your save to actually get anything relevant. So, so yep.
Yes.
Need to have multiple saves, everybody.
Yep. So, anyways... That's pretty much what we've been playing and what we plan to play. Evan and I have been streaming a lot at night, like 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock type deals, or like 9 o'clock Eastern on is like when we typically are streaming. So.
Well, see, the thing is usually I like to start streaming around like 9 o'clock to 11 or 12. But since I've been getting home like pretty much this for the past 2 weeks, it's usually been like 10 or 11.
That's pretty much what I've been streaming at least. And now that I've got the grinding done in Fairy Fencer F, I'm happy with streaming it again because I hate streaming when I'm grinding. So in an RPG.
Here's a question that I don't know the answer to. Is the Call of Duty beta still up?
No, it ended yesterday.
So. Are you serious?
Yep, I was going to ask you about that.
I downloaded it the other day. I was like, I can't believe it's still up because they opened it for people who didn't pre-order it.
Yeah,
it ended. I was like, yeah, download it because I remember sending you a message the other day. I was like, holy crap, it's like 13 gigs for a freaking beta.
Yeah.
Download it. I was like, oh, I'll download it and play it. And I was just remembering, it's like, oh, yeah, I downloaded that. And now it's over.
It's okay. Anthony played it, or one of the people you'll see on our streams a little bit, Anthony Wayman or TNP Mayhem. He downloaded it and played it and said it was crap. So, and he's a big Call of Duty fan. So he's like, "Yep, it's Black Ops again."
Black Ops.
Call of Titanfall. So they added a lot. He criticized it that it's too much like Titanfall. I like Titanfall though.
That's a criticism I can get behind. For me, I like Titanfall too. Yeah. I think Treyarch games and Black Ops are the better Call of Duties, anyways. So to me, that means nothing. That means, oh wow, that sounds like it's going to be really, really fun to me. Because to be honest, Ghosts was okay. Even though I played Advanced Warfare, I still wasn't the biggest fan of it. As I always say, I basically bought Advanced Warfare for the zombies.
Yeah, well, that's pretty much what everyone
I know. A lot of people did.
Yeah, and just occasionally played the multiplayer because it was there. And it was...
At least our age, people buy it for zombies. So,
Look, this new COD, though, not just buying it for zombies, although that is a big purchasing point. I'm buying it because it's Treyarch, and I like Treyarch COD. Yeah. So,
I do, too. World at War was probably my favorite of the Call of Duties that I've played. So,
thoughts on Bioshock Movie, says Prime Rex. Bioshock Movie, probably going to be bombed. Just saying.
Well, it would be pretty easy to do. Yeah. Like, it's all atmospheric.
Borderlands.
He actually met Borderlands. He corrected himself.
Oh, well, Bioshock would be a
Bioshock
movie.
Borderlands movie?
There should be a Bioshock movie. But
there should be a Bioshock movie.
But Borderlands would be good.
Nope.
It's really easy to do Borderlands because all you have to do is like go out to the desert and hear some metal structure or whatever. And you just need to... like. I feel like that would be the lowest production cost out of all of the options for video games. Like, I feel like to do Bioshock right, you have to spend millions and millions of dollars. To do Borderlands right, you don't have to do pretty much anything. Like, here's a desert, here is some random, like, costume. You have to spend more on costumes than you do it into anything.
On makeup and stuff, because let's face it, half of these psychos would be days in makeup getting...
Yeah.
Getting some of that stuff. Honestly, I disagree. I feel like... it would be easy to get the setting right. I don't know how they would tell the story, because if you really think about how they tell the story in Borderlands, half of it is through a comm system. Whoa. And it's just you running around shooting things. And yes, at the time, it's funny the way you, because you're playing the video game, but trying to adapt that into a movie, how are you going to tell a story that's normally told through a comm system while just going around and shooting things? Because it actually, it's, your character is basically a mute for the most part. So it's like, how do you create an interesting character that also tells the story of Borderlands that's not boring as hell? That's all I'm going to say.
Well, for me, it would be relatively simple. So you get one of the member of one of the major corporations, okay? And you have this concept of a vault hunter. Okay, we don't need to focus on the vault hunters we already have. All we need to do is tell the story of four people journeying, being a vault hunter. Yeah, exactly. Being a vault hunter and seeing like what that is, seeing the locals being ambushed by wildlife, making an epic journey, raiding something, like going through a skag pit and like having like hundreds of skags on screen instead of like the max 10 that have, and like things are spitting acid, and you know, like more of a horror movie aspect where like one of the party members gets burned alive from acid and things like that.
That is a complete departure of what Borderlands is. That would be a horrible idea. You're wrong.
I think it would do it justice. And what would you do in Borderlands? Suck at symbols every 5 seconds on midgets?
Like, people come to Borderlands. I guess some people go for this random loot system, which honestly I've never. It's some of the guns are really fun.
Useless loot.
Yeah, but a lot of it is completely useless that you have to constantly manage, and honestly, it's sort of annoying. People go for the characters and the comedy of what's going on rather than the actual the concept of it. I don't know how to really say it, because like, there's a ton of memorable characters in Borderlands. The way you're talking about doing the movie is just completely different. I'm talking
about scenes, not characters. There's a difference there, Evan. You can still have the character and the snarky attitude. That doesn't have to go away. I'm saying that plot-wise, this is an easy way to go through a Borderlands movie that's respectable that can be done in an hour and a half. So, I mean, like,
it be longer than that.
I feel okay, like. Okay, whatever. So, anyways, Legend of Zelda movie. So,
let's agree to disagree on that.
So that's something we can all get behind, because I think we've all played Legend of Zelda. And
show.
No.
Well, excuse me, Princess.
Oh my gosh, why did you say that?
Because I just sat down and actually watched that with my children.
Why would you expose your kids to that? That's a child abuse.
Yeah. They happened to come across something they were watching, and I was like, yeah, that's actually Zelda.
That's what Zelda used to be.
It hurts. Like, seriously. That was the worst. Okay.
I'm not talking about the cartoon. When I say the Zelda TV show, wasn't Netflix supposed to do a TV thing? Didn't Nintendo announce that a while ago? Whatever happened to that? We haven't heard anything about that.
Well, it was announced that it was announced, pretty much. So it's not.
Yeah.
It's not going to. We're not going to see it till like 2018, from what I remember.
Probably. It's probably being still in pre-production at the moment, I'd think. So all the planning and nitty gritty, figuring out who's doing what, and still scripting stuff.
Yeah. Well, I don't.
It's gonna be a while.
I don't think they're. I think if Nintendo does an original story, it's going to be an original story, because the Hero of Time, the lore with Link is that there is always a hero. So regardless of which timeline you're in, he always surfaces when Hyrule or, I guess, Termina needs him for whatever.
Termina, Hyrule, man. Hyrule.
Well, it is Hyrule, but in Termina, it's in more games, actually, than Hyrule. So.
Yep. What?
It's Termina is in Majora's
Mask. That's Majora's Mask, yeah.
Is Majora's Mask, has a field in Ocarina of Time, if I remember correctly, as well as a Legend of Seasons, Legend of, or Rod of Ages, or
Oracle of Ages and Gorge of Seasons. Come on, man. Get it right.
Well, it's...
I'm sorry. I'm very picky about my Zelda stuff. I know my Zelda stuff.
Yeah, I know. So,
Oracle of Ages and Oracle of Seasons.
Yes. So, which is ironic because those are my favorite Zelda games. But
I played those a lot on Game Boy. Yeah. I played those to death. They were hard for me to beat when I was a kid because you had to keep going back and forth. And for some reason, that was a very complicated concept to me.
Yep.
But, yeah, no, those were great.
Yeah, and then, I don't know, I just think they would do better if they just made their own original story and not try to be, like, Ocarina of Times or Majora's Mask's Link or things like that. It's just, you know, I would be actually be more interested in something completely off the wall. Like, and of course no one else will be, so just hear me out here. But I'd be more interested if, like, Link in a steampunk setting. Like, or Link in a futuristic setting. Or Link...
I think we're eventually getting to that, to be honest. They've already had Link in a steam train, I'm just saying.
Yep, so Spirit Tracks was the best Zelda game ever made.
I never even finished that game. I played it, I got about halfway through it, and I said, this is just really dumb. the thing is, it's like, you can't have... The way to bring Link into the future can't be the same as our version of the future. Because everybody's like, oh yeah, let's bring Link into like the modern century with cars and things like that. Well, it's like, no, I think it has to be, you know, Hyrule's version of our modern century.
Sort of like how
Legend of Korra did it. They brought it into sort of a modern century, but they brought it into their own version of their modern century.
And I would
It cuts within their world.
Cocoons have resumed their rightful places as overlords of everything. And
I feel like, you know, you can have sort of modern versions of weapons that maybe work a different way, you know, sort of modern technology and magic work in sync with each other rather than, you know, maybe like how we would see it, like, oh, modern technology takes over magic sort of deal. I feel like they if they're going to bring Link into a modern century, then they should do something to that effect. So when it comes to steampunk, I feel like, why put a train in Zelda? Why don't you just make it their own version of something of that technology, you know?
Well, and I'm just getting ideas of, like, Fi's the spirit of the Master Sword. She goes into the Master Sword. Spoilers for Skyward Sword, if you haven't played that. But it's supposed to be the prequel of all the Zeldas. And she goes into the Master Sword and is the spirit of the Master Sword for Link's throughout the ages. Well, what if, like, she gets to the digital age and, like, she get her the medal of the Master
Sword? It's like that sword from Transistor.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's what I'm going after. And or she gets reforged into something else that's like not a sword, or but not that I'm like a huge fan of that. But you know, that like the metal of the Master Sword kind of becomes like something different, i.e., a gun or something like that. And it's not a Zelda game at that point without a sword, but. You know, or like is an energy sword of some kind, you know, like that type of thing. And I would think that would be more of an interesting setting. One that I would be more intrigued, and I know no other Zelda fan would want to watch it because...
I'm just going to throw this out there. You're totally stealing that from Kingdom Hearts.
What?
Sora's Keyblade already transforms in Kingdom Hearts 3. You're stealing it.
What?
Yeah, Sora's Keyblade, now he can now transform it into different guns and other things now. Where have you been?
I don't keep watch up with KH3 as much as you do.
Watch the latest trailer. It's been in the past 4 trailers he's been transforming his stuff.
Yeah, well, I haven't been... I mean, I'm not like a super big KH fan to start with. I mean, I want to experience it, but I haven't played through one of the games fully yet, so... There's that, Evan. So...
Call yourself a fan.
I don't call myself a fan. I say I'm anticipating it. So
it's okay, Evan. It's okay. You've got me.
Thank you. Thank you, Alice. I mean, Alice knows what's up. And she's got 2 kids. Come on. She's been keeping up on the lore. She knows what's happening.
Probably more for the Disney stuff than the actual...
My kids like JRPGs. Thank you very much.
Oh, your kids are awesome. Your kids are the best. So.
My kids are going through Dragon Quest right now, and I promised them Shadow Hearts afterwards. So
I tell you,
yes,
like,
high five through the webcam. Yeah. Being on my side. All right. Enough picking on Chris.
It was just super funny because we actually met in real life. I know this is scary when people meet and online. And then they meet in real life to do stuff. But, like, her kids are just the best. Like, they were just talking to me the whole time. And you got this, like, you knew, like, oh my gosh, I'm talking to someone that's on YouTube that plays video games.
My kids have seen all your channels because I have you on the subscription list and I'm logged in on their computers. So they see your stuff come across.
Yeah.
And we got to the zoo and my oldest one, Vincent, goes, should we call him Captain Chris or what are we supposed to call him? Like, no. No, you don't.
You could call me Chris. It doesn't really matter. I don't know if you could do the Mr. Davis thing or whatever.
Yes, that's what they were supposed to call you. Yeah. But the whole time, they were just like, Squirrel Game!
Squirrel Guy! He does the Squirrel Game!
Squirrel Game Mom won't let me play because she doesn't want me to break the computer.
Squirrel-topia is the most rage-inducing game I've ever played in my life. So besides,
yeah, I can second that.
Besides Battlefield 2, because of the lag and the hackers, was more infuriating, but that's it.
EVE Online, 6 months of hard work of your life shot out by some expletive, okay?
Yes.
Okay. 6 months gone.
That's EVE in a nutshell. 6 months of spreadsheets, man.
6 months. Okay. All right, let's bring it back to the Zelda thing for a second. Prime Rex. Prime Rex says in the chat, he says, Link is young, about 10 years old, when he goes from Hyrule into Majora's Mask, which is about right. Then the actor is older, he's ready for Twilight Princess. Should Link be set in a dark Batman Arkham-type game?
Do we get to dress Zelda up like Harley if we do that? Anna, can you get on that?
That would be the best. Zelda goes crazy, and we have to get the Triforce reunited to restore her sanity. So she literally becomes the villain, like possessed by Ganon, and is like goes like crazy. And
starts calling you Puddin.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, jeez. She's like, no, she's got like Stockholm syndrome from constantly getting like kidnapped from Ganon all the time. So Ganon's like the new. And she's Harley Quinn, and you're on a quest to save Princess Zelda by getting all the Triforce. You have to get the Triforce of Wisdom to give it back to her to get all of her smarts back. I like this idea. It's a great idea. First of all, I want to ask this, though. Is he insinuating that the Link from Majora's Mask is the same one in Twilight Princess? Because they're not.
They're not. They're really not.
I'm sorry, I'm being really picky.
I think he's just saying use the same actor.
Nerd rage. Evan's about it.
They're not the same one.
I've got that nerd rage.
Although the Link
love
from
that power up in Fallout.
The same Majora's Mask Link is the shade, the hero's shade in Twilight Princess. However, they are not. The Link in that game is not the same from Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask.
All right, here's a Zelda topic. Anyway, since we're on Zelda, who is your favorite helper as far as the Zeldas go? Midna, Tattle, Navi, Fee.
Hey, listen.
Yeah, well, you do that voice way too much. Well, no.
Way too much. Well.
Yes.
Way too much. Well.
Yes.
Love your speech today, Chris.
Yes, I know.
He's nailing
it. You're missing one. You're missing one, and I'm going to say that this one that you're missing is my favorite one.
I was giving examples.
King of Red Lions from Wind Waker.
Oh, okay. The Red Lion.
King of Red Lions. Although, if he's your partner for the most of the things, although there are several other people that do talk to you through that little stone thing. It's mostly him.
Yes.
I like him.
I wish the bird girl would have stuck around Medley. She was like my favorite character in the whole Wind Waker. So I wish she would have stuck around for more. So, and I like Tetra quite a bit. But, yep, I think for me, Tattle, it has to be – Tattle or Midna has to be my favorite. Because Tattle was like anti-Navi. Like, she was experiencing the world with you, if that makes sense. Midna,
that makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah. Midna had a little bit of snark to her, which is what I like. Is I don't like it when it's like, oh, I'm 99% exposition and no character. I really liked Midna and how she actually mattered to the plot. Unlike Navi, who lies to you and pretty much does nothing other than cause enemies to attack you and hover above. Yeah.
What was
and give you nightmares.
Yep.
Yeah. I know, right?
What was that theory? We were talking about this a while back, Chris. You had this theory that Navi is the only reason that any of the enemies actually attack you because she's always in their face all the time.
Yep. So I was watching Evan stream because he streams Zelda. And, of course, I noticed something. The enemies would not attack Evan until Navi would highlight over them. And I was like, oh my gosh. She's the reason enemies are hostile to Link. So, yep. So that's what I noticed. It's not really that way, but it's fun too.
I'm sorry. I just saw what Ayla's put in. Perfect. Do it.
You know what?
Hey, I'm calling your wife. I'm doing it.
Anna,
that's gonna be her
that.
First words. Is, hey, listen.
Record that for
that's
the channel.
Your first words. Your daughter is perfect.
Because if I have follower alerts on, which I don't have for the podcast, because I don't want to like end the podcast. But I have her doing voice and whatever, and I'm gonna actually ask you to do some voice work for other things like donate and whatever. But one of the things I will kind of like want to have her do is like, hey, listen, Captain Chris, listen. When anyone's my channel, I'm like, that would be perfect. So, because if you don't know, Locked on Target show is like a sci-fi type thing, and Anna to my right is my Cortana type person, who is my who's my digital assistant, who
can I be your driver?
Super computer, way smarter than any that shall ever exist.
Yes.
No, Jarvis is pretty smart.
No, Anna's pretty much smarter than Jarvis, but I know her backstory. You guys don't, so.
Well, I know part of my backstory.
Yeah.
It's a good portion of my backstory, anyway.
That's an interesting notion in its own right. I feel like Cortana and Jarvis should be put against each other in a match. It's like, which computer face is better? It's like, yeah, I mean, like, death they all battle. Have their, yeah, death battles. It's like, which one is
be a death battle?
Eevee wins.
Yes. And the tournament shall be hosted by GLaDOS.
I don't know.
Very nice. It's Cortana and Jarvis. They get their own little robot, and they just get pushed through test chambers to see if they can figure stuff out. Yes, I like that idea.
That would be an awesome series. Someone should animate that.
And then GLaDOS would just make fun of would make computer based jokes about all of their OS, and it's like, I don't know. I can't think of any jokes at the moment, but GLaDOS would just make fun of both of them. It's like, oh, you could pilot 43 Iron Man suits at once, but you can't get over this jump. You're so stupid.
Yes. Like, and, feel well, like you can that make needs a bunch to... of robot jokes like Terminator jokes and like you can't climb stairs and
bam. Yep. 7 more seconds of cooperation. Way to go, robot.
So but yeah, I mean, honestly, this month is going to be crazy cuz Metal Gear Solid just released, which I want to resist picking up, but it's kind of looking like I need to. So, for the sake of things, but eventually Anna and I will actually be putting on Twitch shows for you guys, hopefully live Twitch shows where we go back and forth as we're playing games, as me Captain Chris flying through space and her berating me and us joking around. But I need to pay her for that because her money is worth, her time is worth the money. So
my money is worth the time.
That's right. So because I can't speak today because I got 1 hour of sleep last night. So yep, host a podcast when you got 1 hour. It's a good plan, guys. But yeah, we have pretty much talked about MGS5, pretty much everything. So what are you guys' plans for the rest of the week as far as your channels go and stuff? Self promote time. So until when
ladies first go.
Anna, you first.
Okay, fine. We're all just like quite like, no, you go first. You go first. Okay, so basically, I am going to be doing my usual Let's Plays for the week. I'm going to be posting a Critter Crunch video later today after I get it edited. The last night of Five Nights at Freddy's for me is going to go out. And then probably some Starbound and things like that. And then, of course, Friday, I'm actually going to be doing a part 2 for the first time for an art video. And I'm going to take the King K. Rool fan art that I started a couple weeks ago, and I'm going to detail it even more to take it into more of a finished piece stage.
Awesome.
Yeah, and then I'm going to release that as a free desktop download if you want to use it. And then Saturday, I don't know what I'm doing. Probably another gaming video for Saturday. Haven't decided what yet. And then Sunday will probably be another Level Up Life episode, though I am in the process of creating a new opener for that, which is going to lead me into creating graphics for another thing,
a show I test piloted it a while back. Chris, I think, probably remembers
yes.
it. I need to bring that show back. I'm working on it. I've got so many ideas for it. It's going to be really, really cool and really awesome and so campy cheesy in such a great internet video sort of way.
Yep.
I just got to get some assets created for it, for like title animations and stuff. And then I'm going to be working on a few other things. So lots of Level Up Life stuff as I work on getting back in shape.
Gosh, Anna, so, I got to actually do work this week, not watch your stuff. Ah, darn it. There goes my week.
Well, it's a good thing it's YouTube. You can watch it again later.
I know, right?
You can binge watch one day.
So, Gandalf the Pink, this is the Save Point Online podcast where we're just wrapping up. So you're kind of...
You
missed the good stuff.
Yeah, you missed all the good stuff. Yeah.
So. What the hell is this? It is
the
amazing
self-promote video time where we kind of wrap up. So, yeah. Sorry, bud. Let's do this. Every Monday, we podcast at 1 o'clock. You may notice it's not Monday because we suck this week and we had to delay it. So, every Monday, 1 o'clock. So,
or most Mondays.
Maybe yeah, most we'll Mondays. Most Mondays.
As soon as I said, yeah, my boss gives me off Mondays now because of such and such, we should probably be able to do them most Mondays now. And then the week after I tell him that, guess what? I have to work on Monday for some reason. It's like,
Yep.
It's like, really?
So Mondays 1 Eastern is our schedule, hopefully, usually. And we will pretty much be doing this as a regular thing, unless that follow me on Twitter if you want to see if it's being delayed, because I'll post on Twitter, hey guys, sorry the podcast isn't happening, and I'll tell you why, all that type of thing.
Yeah.
So and you can find me at YouTube/LockedOnTargetShow or down on this is my Twitch channel, so you can follow the links there. Or follow if you want to see us when we go live. I stream almost every night, or when my wife is at work, which she works almost every night now. So I stream JRPGs, FPS games, and lots of things, and probably Guild Wars 2 once Guild Wars 2's new expansion pack comes out. So
I might join you with that one.
Yes, that'll be awesome. So. All right, but for me, as far as other things I do Save Point Online, which hopefully the website will be up this week, and getting final stuff where I can start posting reviews, news, all that kind of stuff, because I'm trying to start like a gaming community. And I also am doing Let's Plays every day on my channel, as well as reviews, which I do 20 minutes of gameplay, then follow it up with a category review system. I call it 20 minutes of game. Then I do the podcast every Monday with these fine folks, and then hopefully some guests starting soon to get some more guests on. And that's pretty much it for my channel. So I'm pretty active in the community, so...
For mine this week, I have a giveaway running over on my YouTube channel, which is Alice Andura. I'm giving away a For the Horde little silver ring because of WoW's new Legion expansion, and the winner is going to be picked on Friday, so there's still plenty of time to enter. I also am going to have the next episode in my Fallout New Vegas series. We're going to be working more on some modded content, some big, big mods where you get to rebuild some buildings and kind of run the casino, which is going to be a lot of fun. I'm also going to be doing another discussion video about starting to date people in gaming, so using MMOs and things like that to find your significant others, including stories about my stalkers, so it'll be great fun.
Yep, and she actually met her husband online.
Yes, I did.
So
On an MMO, yeah.
Yep, that's the finest.
I should start playing some MMO.
Don't play an MMO to find a girl, Evan. So, yeah, Guild Wars 2 actually has a lot of females in it. Just saying.
All right, Anna, we're gonna be a wingman to each other when we start playing Guild Wars 2. All right, that's what's gonna happen. We're gonna play Guild Wars 2.
Yep.
Chris is gonna show us how, and then we're just gonna, you'll be my wingwoman. Yeah, and I'll be your wingman. And we're just, yeah, there you're good to go. This is how we find love in the 21st century. Yes.
How we're LFG, do it. Looking for, and, oh, it's great. You can have a digital wedding now. Lion's Arch actually has, like, the a very beautiful spot, actually, for, like, the wedding arch and whatnot.
Yeah.
It, like, overlooks the water and whatnot. It's actually a really pretty spot, so... I can be minister at your digital wedding.
Go, for
your
digital LFGF, looking for girlfriend.
Looking for girls.
LFGF.
Yeah.
That's the thing is, the guild I'm a part of, well, that's what I actually like about MMOs in general, is there's a lot of actual people that play MMOs, not like bros that kind of play FPS games, where... you know, like, there are actually people that I could talk parenting with and all sorts of stuff. That play MMOs and adult stuff that really doesn't apply to most gaming. So.
Fine, I'll play it. You don't have to twist my arm anymore, Chris.
Whatever, bro.
I'm just going to throw this out there. Throughout this entire podcast, they're just like, it's not that easy. You know, it's not that hard. It's free to play now. I'll teach you how to play it. Anna likes to play it. Oh, yeah, you could maybe find a girlfriend, Evan. Come on. He's like trying everything. He's trying to find
He's
everything.
He's like dangling
he
the bait in front of you.
Yep.
It's just right there. It's just like, oh, everything you want is right here, Evan. Just play Guild Wars 2 and you can have it all. And you can be like me, married with children and still playing games in my own basement.
There's in Guild Wars 2, there's a woman for any type. Whether you're in for the small girls, you got the Asuras, you got the furries
stop,
with the char.
Stop with that. Get out of here. Shut up.
Steven Herbal, looking for waifu.
Yeah, looking for waifu.
Love it.
So, yep, that's how we wrap up. We even wrap up off topic. So,
yep, we do.
What are you doing, Evan? What are you going to do?
What are you going to do, Evan?
What are you doing? What are you doing this week?
Don't stop just yet. I am not looking for... looking hard enough, apparently, for love on the internet, because I don't play MMOs, apparently.
Nerd talks, man. It'll get you there.
I already did one. I
talk
did a waifu
nerdy to me.
I already did a waifu topic Nerd Talks video already. You gotta go watch.
You need to talk animu, and you need to talk, like, I'm serious. There's a bunch of weeb girls that love to play games, and that's...
Weeb girls?
They're...
What are these terms you speak of? What is weeb girls?
Weeaboos.
Chris, you're grounded from the internet.
What? What? Weeb girls are a thing. They are absolutely a thing.
What is weeb girls? What is that?
Chat, help me out here. Chat, I know this is a delay. Weebs are a thing. Weeb girls are also a thing.
What is the term weeb? Never
it's
heard
short
that.
For weeaboo, which is kind of, it's like an extreme otaku. Yeah.
It's a derogatory term for otaku.
Yeah, it is the people that want to speak Japanese and like want to be Japanese. So weebs are generally like okay. So you know how people used to call us nerds back in the day when we were
still a nerd.
That's pretty much what weebs are at this point. Is they like Japanese things. And they like Japanese products and whatnot. Like, people could level the criticism that I'm a weeb. I don't want to be Japanese or anything, but I like anime and I like JRPGs quite a bit. So, I wouldn't call myself a weeb, but if you criticized me, it would be neckbeard and weeb. Those would be the two things that the interwebs could throw at me. Seriously, though, I'm saying that if you really want to get a knockdown gorgeous girl, get into anime. Okay,
so I'm into anime.
They might be into like the
conference a month ago about anime.
You know, I did make an anime channel on YouTube. I haven't done anything.
I have to try. I'm just saying.
Maybe I should rename it to Chris and Evan Talk Anime. And then we can do, like, co-op things.
You can be, a little offshoot side podcast.
Yep.
All the animus.
Yep. And we'll talk about how Mirai Nikkei is actually, like, the archetype that you're going to be going for You know, the lured stalker killer girl?
That is.
It's called Future Diary in English, and it is a really
creepy... I haven't even heard of that one either.
It's like Hunger Games, but... it's a contest. Everyone is like this isolation loner or socially deranged sociopath, and they all get diaries of the future that they take on their cell phones. Okay, so,
Hold on. Let's end the podcast, shall we?
No, I want to explain this. Let me explain this first.
I haven't even done my self-promotion
okay,
yet.
Okay, do your freaking self-promotion.
Two tangents we've gone on already. I'm not done. Stop it. Right?
Okay, go ahead. Promote your stuff.
I'm redlining that microphone right now. I keep backing up because I keep screaming into the microphone.
It's okay. We'll attract plenty of 13-year-olds. They'll think we're playing horror games.
Hi. I'm having the pixel push. I do YouTube stuff, too. I play video games about pretty much anything. Right now, I'm playing the Jet Force Gemini off the Rare Replay, and I'm also playing Life is Strange. I also am experimenting with a new series called Thinking Out Loud, which is basically a series of a bunch of topics / rant videos / theory videos of pretty much anything I feel like talking about, gaming or nerd related or anything like that. I just put up my first episode of that last week. It's on gamers caring about other gamers. I have a few other things I probably going to be recording here soon. I also have a series called Beginner's Luck, where it's a first impression series where I record myself playing a game for the very first time. You get to see me stumble and fall and do all that sorts of stuff. And then I sort of do a short review on it at the end and tell you whether I think it's worth playing or keep playing or whatever. So there you go. Find me on youtube.com/pxlpushers. Look for the big red and white X. I'm done. Okay.
Sorry, we're not being chat.
Done. So. Finished. Yeah.
Yes, we're done with what we need to talk about. So, anyways, if you want to talk Animu, then you can. I'll be doing Animu videos soon because why not? And my main channel is gaming. So, that's not going to happen on my main channel. And I have to annoy my, or ignore Anthony, who's calling me during the podcast.
Ah!
Okay. But anyways, we'll just wrap up. And thanks you guys for tuning in. Man, we've had a lot of good people turn in, a lot of good chat. And we will be back next Monday. So until we meet again, stay on target. And everyone else do their outros? Nope.
Awkward ending. Like, favorite, subscribe, and follow. Oh, yeah, I'm also on Twitch at PX11. There you go.
Yep.
Bye.
Bye.